biblical principles of what a church should be
and manifesting the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ.
This is the Hour of Faith, originating from the sanctuary of Faith Baptist Church, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city. As you participate in today's broadcast, may the Lord challenge your heart with the Word.
Good singing. You may be seated.
And we do want to welcome those of you joining us by way of radio, television, and the World Wide Web to the Sunday morning service coming to you from the Faith Baptist Church of Altoona, Pennsylvania, the United States of America. And wherever you are, we do thank you for the pleasure of your company. What a day that will be. You know, that's a part of the glorious hope that we as Christians have, of looking forward to the time when this world will be behind us and we'll be in the presence of Almighty God, either through our own death or the rapture. And either way, we say, amen, so be it, Lord Jesus. And I'm looking forward to that time and trust that you are too, because you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Just a couple of things we want to remind you of. Certainly, if we can ever serve you spiritually speaking, don't hesitate to contact us. You can go to our website, which is www.fbcaltoona.org, or you can even call us at 814-944-2894, and you can learn about us at the website or through that phone call. But certainly, if we can minister to you in any way, I would encourage you to get in contact with us. Now, coming up on Saturday, January the 28th, is the one-day session of the Central Pennsylvania Bible Conference. And, of course, our guest speaker will be Dr. Bill Shade. Our song leader will be Jim O'Brien, as normal. He will also be providing special music for us. And Bill Shade is going to be speaking on bursting the transgender bubble and then distinguishing truth from fantasy. Now, this is a Saturday, January the 28th. We will have a session at 10 o'clock in the morning and then at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, but 11:30. We have a free lunch to all who attend. And boy, you can't beat that with a stick. And, you know, coming up on the cold winter days, it's good to have some warm spiritual fellowship. And so we would invite you. Bill Shade is also going to be speaking for us on Sunday here at the church, the 29th. He'll be speaking on Sounding the Depths of the Mystery of God at 10:30, of Godliness, excuse me. And then in the evening, he will be speaking on the victory of the cross. And so I would encourage you to put those on your calendar. January the 16th is recognized as Religious Freedom Day. You know, the United States of America has been founded on many freedoms. We call them unalienable rights. Freedoms that only God can give to us and no government can take away from us. And yet we know that down through the years, there have been those who have done what they could to try to take away our freedoms. Well, January the 16th is the day that we focus on the freedoms. And I know that some of you are watching this or listening to us beyond January the 16th. That's okay. That's not the issue. The issue is, number one, we ought to thank God for the freedoms that we have in this nation, the religious freedoms. I've had the privilege of visiting 32 nations of the world. And, you know, even though they might be nice places, they don't have the freedoms that we have. We ought to thank God for what we have in America. But those who have put together the Religious Freedom Day have asked us to do three things. Number one, to pray for religious freedom to be valued by public life. Specifically, and I'm reading from an insert that we have in our bulletin today, they say, ask God to help leaders see the religious freedom, that it is an unalienable right, a right that does not have to be forfeited when believers conduct business, engage in public speech, serve in office, or teach in public schools. So pray for the freedom to do that. Then they ask us to promote religious freedom in schools. And, of course, it says here that educators and administrators should celebrate Religious Freedom Day without fear. And it very well may be that some of the school systems throughout central Pennsylvania and across this nation will be celebrating Religious Freedom Day or have done so on January the 16th. But then thirdly, they say prompt Congress and the new president to protect religious freedom in policy and in law. It says that during the campaign, Donald Trump spoke about the need to remove the IRS muzzle on ministers by repealing the Johnson Amendment. In response to this, Representative Steve Scalise and Representative Jody Heiss have introduced Free Speech Fairness Act, which proposes to amend the Johnson Amendment, which means that, you know, the 501c3 status cannot in any way be threatened when a preacher gets up and preaches the Word of God without compromise. So these are some three things to keep before us. Pray that religious freedom will be valued in America. Promote Religious Freedom Day when we can, and prompt those in positions of authority to really stand for our religious freedoms. And then, you know, I'm going to add a fourth. And the fourth is, would you pray for preachers all across this nation that no matter what is out there or what comes up, we will all be willing to preach the Word of God without compromise? Will you pray for that? I think that is one step towards guaranteeing our religious freedoms when preachers preach the Word of God without compromise. So we do invite you to do that. Now we're going to sing another great song. It's got the word sing in it. I will sing the wondrous story of our salvation in Jesus Christ. It's number 615. Those of you joining us by media ministry, sing along with us. The rest of us, we can stand and sing this great hymn of the faith.
Thank you. good singing, you may be seated.
Good morning. Psalm 19:1 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork." And we see God's handiwork all around us, but I am part of God's handiwork because it took a miracle to save me. And that's what I'm going to sing this morning. It took a miracle. My Father is omnipotent, and that you can't deny. A God of might and miracles, it's written in the sky. And it took a miracle to put the stars in place. And it took a miracle to hang this world in space. But when he saved my soul, cleansed and made me whole, that took a miracle of love and grace. Though here his glory has been shown, we still can't fully see the wonder of his might, his power. It will take eternity, for it took a miracle to put each star in space. And it took a miracle to hang this world in the right place. But when he saved my soul, cleansed and made me whole, that took a miracle of love and grace. Well, the Bible tells us of his power and his wisdom all the way through, and every little bird and flower, they are testimonies too. But it took a miracle to put the stars in place. And it took a miracle to hang this world in space. But when he saved my wretched soul, cleansed my heart and made me whole, that took a miracle of love and grace.
Amen. Every salvation is a miracle. Praise the Lord for that. If you have your copy of God's Word with you, turn with me to two passages of Scripture this morning. The first one being Matthew chapter 7, and the second one being 2 Corinthians chapter 13. And I just want to read a portion from both of these. The first one will be Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, and the second one will be 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. Matthew 7, 21 through 23, and 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. And I ask you to stand out of respect for God's word as I read these passages of Scripture, please. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, where the word of God says, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful things? And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And then 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. 2 Corinthians 13 and verse 5, where the Word of God says, examine yourselves, not others. Well, that doesn't say that, but that's the point. Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates. Are you a reprobate? I'm going to talk about that today, but first let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, as we come to you this morning, we thank you for the miracle of salvation. Every time that somebody calls upon the name of the Lord and is saved, salvation, a miracle of salvation has occurred. And we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, now for the opportunity that we have to look into your word and study it. And I pray, Lord, that you'll take this message and use it in each of our hearts today, that we might respond to it in the way that you would have us to respond according to your will. In Jesus' name I pray. And all of God's children said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Ever since the Lord Jesus Christ was on the earth, people have been saying that they are Christian. Many people have said that down through the years, but the question that everyone that says that must ask is this: am I really a Christian? I'm pausing for your thought about that because I would like to encourage you to make it personal. You say you're a Christian? You say you're a Christian? Well, are you sure? Do you know without a shadow of a doubt that you are a Bible-believing, born-again Christian? You see, not everyone that says that he or she is a Christian is really a saved, blood-bought, born-again, Bible-believing Christian according to the Word of God. As a matter of fact, notice the passage of Scripture that we read here in Matthew chapter 7. It is a challenging warning to every one of us. A challenging warning to everyone under the sound of my voice today. The Lord Jesus is speaking. This, of course, is a part of the Sermon on the Mount. And notice what Jesus says in verse 21 of Matthew 7. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Now stop to think about that for a minute. You say you're a Christian? Are you on your way to heaven? Will you be in heaven? Jesus tells us here that not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom, only those who do the will of the Father. And so without the initial obedience to God, somebody, anybody, no one will get into heaven. And that initial obedience is trusting Jesus Christ as Savior. What about you? Have you done that? He goes on to say, many will say to me in that day. What day? Well, the day when the unsaved stand before him at the great white throne judgment. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? At the great white throne judgment, when only the unsaved will be standing before the Lord, there will be those who have said, I have preached, I have taught, I have gone to the mission field, I have sung, I have done so many things in the church, I've done many wonderful works. But verse 23, Jesus says, and then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. See, one cannot be saved without initial obedience to God and trusting Christ as Savior. One cannot be saved with religious activity, and one cannot be saved without a relationship with Christ. That is the pure, unadulterated teaching of the Word of God as it relates to our salvation. And so take it from what Jesus is teaching us here. You may say, Lord, Lord, but have you really trusted Christ as Savior? I submit to you today that right now, as we are gathered here, there are people in hell who thought they were on their way to heaven because of religious activity, but they had never yet trusted Christ as Savior. Don't allow that to be you. Don't allow that to be you. Make sure you know the Lord. Are you a Christian? You say you are. Are you sure? You know, among those who say they are Christian, in reality, there are three separate and distinct categories into which they all fall. And only one of those categories is made up of a real Bible-believing Christian fellowship. We're going to look at those three categories in a moment, and as we do, I would encourage you to take a look at your life and see into which category do you fall. You say you are a Christian, are you really? The point of emphasis is make sure today that you are. Let's begin by asking the question, what is the definition of a Christian? Well, I went to Webster's College Dictionary the other day and found out that it emphasizes four particular points on what a Christian is. Number one, it pertains to or derives from Jesus Christ or His teachings. Number two, according to Webster's College Dictionary, being a Christian pertains to or adhering to the religion based on the teachings of Jesus Christ. Number three, the dictionary says, and listen to this one, a Christian is one who is humble, decent, and generous. Now, I hope that describes all true born-again believers. But you know, you can be humble, decent, and generous, and as lost as a mouse. Think about that. This is how people get led astray, you see. Then, the Webster's College Dictionary also says that a Christian is one who exemplifies the teachings of Jesus Christ. Well, you know, those things certainly have some truth, but that's what error is. Error always has some truth. But the fact of the matter is, this really is not a biblical definition of Christian. As we look at the biblical definition of Christian, I find it interesting to find that the word Christian was formed after the Roman style, signifying an adherent of Jesus Christ, and was applied first of all to believers by the Gentiles in Antioch, back in Acts chapter 11 and verse 26. The interesting thing about that, though, is that true believers did not adopt that title for themselves until after the end of the apostolic era. As a matter of fact, as we look back into history, we find that to most Gentiles, the word Christian implied scorn and was used as vulgarity. And so you see, back in the days of the Acts, and back in the first century, and perhaps even on through to the second century, because they tell us that it wasn't until after the second century A.D. that the term Christian was accepted to be the title of a believer of honor. And so in the first 200 years of Christianity, to be called a Christian was really an insult. It was vulgar. It was not something that Christians said. You know what they referred to themselves as back in those days? People of the way. People of the way. For Jesus Christ is the way and the truth and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by Him. So what really is a Christian, biblically speaking? Well, we talk about it a lot over this pulpit. I want to put it this way this morning, that a Christian is one who, upon realizing his or her personal sin, and recognizing that Jesus Christ is the only true Savior, will then call upon the name of the Lord to save him, which results in the deliverance from sin, its power, its penalty, and its presence through faith in Jesus Christ alone. That could be a good biblical definition of a Christian. One who, upon realizing his personal sin and recognizing that Jesus Christ is the only true Savior, will then call upon the name of the Lord to save him, which results in the deliverance from sin, its power, its penalty, and its presence through faith in Jesus Christ alone. Now let me just pause here to say this. I fully believe, based upon the teaching of the Scripture, based upon Romans 10:13, where it says, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I personally believe that based upon the authority of the Scripture, that if you've not called upon the name of the Lord Jesus to ask Him to save you, you probably aren't saved. So take a look at your life today. Can you find a time when you said something like, Lord Jesus, I trust you to save me. If you haven't, chances are you will be one of those who will stand before the Lord Jesus, and he will say at that great white throne judgment, depart from me. I never knew you. Now stop to think about that for a moment. In the church all your life, on boards and committees, doing certain things for God, and standing before Jesus, him saying, depart from me, I never knew you. I read recently we're up to 85% of people who live in the United States of America say that they're Christian. If that was true, this nation would be living biblical principles. So we need to put this into consideration. What about you? According to Lewis Sperry Schaefer, no less than 33 simultaneous and instantaneous divine undertakings and transformings take place at the moment one exercises faith in Jesus Christ. I talked about that several weeks ago. You know, we talk about calling upon the name of the Lord and asking him to save us, and he does. But think about that. At the moment we say, Lord Jesus, I trust you to save me, at least 33 things take place. Let's put it this way. At least God does at least 33 things in our lives the moment we trust Christ. And therefore, a Christian is not one who does certain things for God, but one for whom God does certain things. What about you? Are you truly saved? I mentioned a moment ago that among those who call themselves Christians, there are three categories. I want to look at those briefly today. You, if you call yourself a Christian, you are in one of those three categories. The first category is the cultural Christian. The second category is the traditional Christian. And the third category is the biblical Christian. Which one are you? Let's take a look. First of all, the cultural Christian. Who's the cultural Christian? Well, the cultural Christian is the person who has chosen to identify with the Christian philosophy and teaching as opposed to any other religion of the world. Now, did you hear that? Please listen. A cultural Christian, is the person who has chosen to identify with the Christian philosophy and teaching as opposed to any other religion of the world. Let's take a look at the cultural Christian's thinking and characteristics and weaknesses and danger. First of all, the thinking of the cultural Christian. There are several things I can bring out here, and of course I don't mean to be all-inclusive because I can't be all-inclusive at this point. I don't have the time. But what I'm going to tell you may be just illustrations as to what it means to be a cultural Christian. First of all, the thinking of the cultural Christian would be that he or she is not an atheist. They do believe that there's a God. But James chapter 2 and verse 19 tells us that even the devil believes that there's a God, right? And trembles. Then another element of the thinking of the cultural Christian would be, well, I'm not Jewish. Why? Because he would recognize that, probably speaking, at least that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. So he says, I'm not Jewish. In addition, the cultural Christian would think, I'm not a Muslim. Why? Because he does not adhere to Sharia law, which is the code, the law that governs Islamic activity, lifestyle, and religion. Then the cultural Christian would not say, I'm not a Hindu. Why? Because he's not following the common religion of the land of India. In addition, he would probably say, or she would probably say, I know the cultural Christian would not think, well, I'm not a Satanist, because they don't actively worship Satan. And you know, you could go on and on and on, but you get the point. The cultural Christian would be one who would deny association with any other religion of the world except Christianity. Which leads us to the characteristics of the cultural Christian. What kind of characteristics would we see in the person who has aligned himself with the philosophy of Jesus Christ as opposed to the other religions of the world? Well, The cultural Christian probably does recognize that Jesus is the Savior of the world. However, we are finding more and more today that not only the cultural Christian, but sometimes the traditional Christian and sometimes the liberal Christian will say, well, there may be other ways to heaven beside Jesus Christ. Well, I remind us all there's only one way to heaven, and that's through faith in Christ alone. Because only Christ went to the cross. Only Christ suffered and bled and died for us and rose again on the third day. But the characteristic of the cultural Christian is that he would recognize that Jesus is the Savior of the world. However, the cultural Christian would rarely attend the church. You will rarely see a cultural Christian in church. As a matter of fact, you'll rarely see them interested in any kind of a Christian ministry. It's just not a part of their repertoire to be too closely aligned with the church or the Christian ministry. Another characteristic of the culture of Christian is that he lacks biblical knowledge. He does not know the Word of God. Yesterday at the Way of Truth board meeting, it was our annual board meeting, and John Delosier gave a tremendous message, devotional, out of the book of Hosea and chapter 13, I think it was, or 8, or somewhere in the book of Hosea. I want to find it because I want to read it to you because I might deliver a message on it one of these nights, one of these days. It's Hosea chapter 8 and verse 12, where God says, I have written to him, that talking about Israel, I have written to him the great things of my law, but they were counted as a strange thing. And certainly we can say that to the cultural Christian, the thing of God's word, the things of God's word are strange. He or she doesn't know them, and if she does know anything about them, does not adhere to them. And then another characteristic of the cultural Christian is that he maintains a secular thought, a secular worldview. He does not see life through the eyes of the Scripture, but rather sees life through the eyes of the world and the things of the world. Am I describing you? Possibly. You are a cultural Christian because you're not a Jew or a Muslim or a Hindu or a Satanist or an atheist or anything else. Well, this leads us to the weakness of the cultural Christian. And the weakness is the fact that the cultural Christian has no relationship with Christ, has never been saved, has never been born again, has never trusted Christ as Savior. The Bible teaches this in the book of Hebrews, Ephesians chapter 2, that the cultural Christian is without God and without hope in this life. Simply a say-so Christian, not really born again, having no hope of heaven, but yet, the cultural Christian will say, everything's okay with me and God, when in reality that's a deception and things aren't okay. Which leads us to the danger of the cultural Christian. The danger of the cultural Christian, and again, keep in mind, we are talking about the person who has chosen to identify with the Christian philosophy and teaching as opposed to any other religion of the world. The danger that this person is under is that right now the cultural Christian is under the wrath of God. Turn with me, if you would please, to John chapter 3 and verse 36. The Gospel of John, chapter 3, and verse 36. Many times we read this verse in application to those who are unsaved. Well, I believe, as I understand what a cultural Christian is, that the cultural Christian is unsaved. And notice what it says in verse 36 of John 3. It says, he that believes on the Son has everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the what? Wrath of God abideth on him. Listen, the cultural Christian is in danger now because now God's wrath is upon them, meaning that they are on their way to a Christless eternity. And they will die without Christ and go to the lake of fire, according to Revelation chapter 20, verses 14 and 15, where it says that those whose names are not written in the Lamb's book of life are cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. I tell you today, as I'm standing here before you, that there are hundreds and thousands and millions of people in hell today who were cultural Christians. They aligned themselves with Christianity because they didn't align themselves with any other religion in the world, and they were lost and died under the wrath of God, and they will be in eternal hell forever. Could that be you today? They tell us today that many people who claim to be a Christian live a worldly lifestyle. That, in fact, not too long ago, there was a survey conducted that I think it said something like 70% of those who claim to be Christians have no different of a lifestyle than those who claim not to be Christian. Why would that be? One of the reasons is because they're cultural Christians and not biblical Christians. They're apart from Christ. What about you? Really, what about you? The second type of category that Christians could be put into, or those who claim to be Christians would be put into, is the traditional Christian category. Now, I think that this is even more serious than the cultural Christian. The traditional Christian is the person who claims Christianity because of his national, ecclesiastical, educational, or familial background. In other words, the traditional Christian is the one who says, I'm a Christian because I am born in a certain nation, or go to a certain church, or have a certain education, or belong to a certain family. In fact, let me, if I may, just be able to play this out a little bit more with you as we look at the thinking of the traditional Christian. Those who are traditional Christians will say this, that because I was born in the United States of America, that is commonly referred to as a Christian nation, I am a Christian. I want to tell you something. Being born in the United States of America makes nobody a Christian. Nobody. Another part of the thinking of the traditional Christian is that they'll say, well, I've been brought up in a church, and that makes me a Christian. I've been baptized. I take the Lord's table. I go through all the religious activity and ritual. Listen, going to a Christian church does not make you a Christian any more than going into McDonald's makes you a hamburger. Doesn't. It just doesn't. Years ago, there was a movement called corporate evangelism and corporate salvation. And corporate salvation in those days taught that if you join a local church that preaches the Bible, that makes you a Christian. Again, joining a church does not make anybody a Christian. The only way to be a Christian is to trust Christ as Savior. Another aspect of the thinking of the traditional Christian is that, well, I went to Christian school all my life. I went to Blair County Christian School. Well, good for Blair County Christian School, but going to Blair County Christian School doesn't make you a Christian any more than going to any other school. But there's a lot of people who think that because they went to a Christian school or went to a Christian college of some sort, that makes them Christian. Then here's another part of the thinking of the cultural Christian, of the traditional Christian. They say, well, I was brought up in a Christian home. That makes me a Christian. My grandparents were Christian. My parents were Christian. So I must be a Christian. You're looking at one guy who thought that at one time. I believed that one time that because my grandparents were Christian and one was even a preacher and his name was Michael. I mean, that's being pretty close to Michael the archangel. I actually thought at one point that if anybody would go to heaven, it would be me because of my Christian background. But that does not make you a Christian. You see, those who've been brought up in the Christian home and in the Christian church and even in a Christian school, those people know some biblical terms. They know some of the Bible. And they know some of the songs that we sing. And I want to tell you, that's very dangerous because there could be people singing How Great Thou Art all the way to the great white throne judgment and be cast into the eternal lake of fire because they've never trusted Christ as Savior. Parents, if you have your children in Christian school, Christian church, and in the Christian home, do everything that you can to make sure that you make sure that you know that they know that they're truly born again, Bible believing, not just because they know the terminology of Christianity. When you say, what are the characteristics of the traditional Christian? Well, several things here to consider. Number one, they will maintain some type of a moral code or code of ethics. Might try to follow the Ten Commandments, which we know that nobody can keep them anyway. They will probably be religious. They follow a certain religious ritual. They probably are morally good, which means that they will avoid open sin, but are usually very judgmental of others. They might even give to the church and certain charities because they think it's the thing to do. And you know what? Every now and then, they might even go to church. They're Christers, or even thankful Christers, which means they go Thanksgiving, Christmas, and Easter. And they might be birthers because they'll go on their birthday. And they may go some other times, but you see, they do it simply because they feel it's an obligation, or they feel as though they're doing God a favor. Now, there may be other characteristics of the traditional Christian, but do you understand where I'm going? Do you get the point? You get the point. Traditional Christians aren't born again just because they were brought up in a certain nation or a certain church or a certain family or a certain school. That leads us to the weakness of the traditional Christian, which the fact is the traditional Christian probably does not have a personal relationship with God. And yet he or she thinks that everything's okay with God. God's good. All the time. But just because of being born in a certain nation or going to a certain church or being educated in a certain way or going to being a part of a certain family does not make one a Christian, which leads us to the danger. And you know, the danger of the traditional Christian is the same as the danger of the cultural Christian. That person is under the wrath of God now. And if they would die now, they would go to the eternal, they would go to hell, awaiting the eternal lake of fire. And they will stand before the great white throne judgment. And Jesus will say to you, yes, you went to church. Why, Jesus might say, you even went to Faith Baptist Church of Altoona. But depart from me. I never knew you. I know a fellow, a friend of mine. I would say he's a traditional Christian. In fact, I know that he is. He never goes to church. Well, he might be a thankful Christer. But I do know this. Before he goes and does anything that he wants to do on Sunday, he will stop by the church and put in a tithe. But he won't go. Got too many things to do. I've talked with this fellow numerous times, and when you begin to talk to him about the Lord, he'll say, well, you know, we have to do God a favor every now and then. And he owns a particular business, you see, and sometimes he uses that business for the Lord. And I don't know how many times he said to me, well, got to sort of help God out every now and then. But that's how a traditional Christian thinks. Could that be you? The final category that Christians fall into is the biblical Christian. I gave a definition of what a Christian is earlier in the message, and it's you know, one that says that a Christian is one who, upon realizing his personal sin and recognizing that Jesus Christ is the only true Savior, will call upon the name of the Lord to save him, which results in the deliverance from sin, its power, its penalty, and its presence through faith in Jesus Christ alone. And the fact of the matter is that a biblical Christian is one who realizes that Jesus Christ alone is the Savior and that he is the only one, the only way to heaven, and the real Christian is the one who's called upon the name of the Lord to ask you to save him. Have you done that? Again, let's play this out a little bit to become just a little bit more specific and look at the thinking of the biblical Christian. The biblical Christian knows that he has been born in sin because Romans chapter 5, 12 says that death has come upon all men because all have what? The thinking of the biblical Christian is that he knows he is a sinner because Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, including him. The thinking of the biblical Christian is that he knows there's a penalty to pay for sin. The wages of sin is what? Death. Eternal separation from God. But the biblical Christian also knows and thinks in his thinking that Jesus Christ is the gift of God because Romans 6:23 says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Part of the thinking of the biblical Christian is that he knows he has to call upon the name of the Lord to be saved because Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be what? And so that's the thinking of the biblical Christian. I ask you today, is that your thought today? Do you realize that you have been born in sin and that you are a sinner and that there's a penalty to pay for sin and that Jesus Christ is the gift of God? And have you called upon the name of the Lord to save you? Folks, if you don't align yourself with that biblical truth, then you may be religious, you may be a church member, you may be a member of this church or any other church, but chances are you're not biblically born again. You need to look at your life. Well, that leads us to the characteristics of the biblical Christian. And I want to ask you to turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. I do not have the time to dig into all of this today, but I would like for you to see it. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, particularly verses 3 through 10, there are 11 characteristics of the biblical Christian. 11. I'm just going to highlight them for your own evaluation. You might want to mark them, beginning with verse 3. It says, Paul and Silas and Timothy were writing to the Christians in Thessalonica. He says, remembering without ceasing your work of faith. The first characteristic of the biblical Christian is that there is a faith that works. In other words, true Christians bear fruit. True Christians bear fruit. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. The second thing we see, he says, you have a labor of love. What that teaches us is that true Bible-believing Christians have a labor of love. That means sacrificial service for the Lord. They don't do just what they want to do for the Lord. They do what God calls them to do, and they sacrificially do it. The third characteristic of the true Christian is that, as Paul says, you have a patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of His coming. That teaches us that the true believer has a hope that endures. He keeps focused on the rapture, and he does not give up in trials. He does not give up serving the Lord because he knows that one of these days he'll hear the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and Jesus Christ will say, come up hither, and he's not going to quit until that day. Number four, another characteristic of the biblical Christian is that he or she has a reception of the gospel. You look at verse 4. An understanding of election. You look at verse 4 where Paul says, knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God. You see, the true born-again believer understands the process and the certainty of salvation. There's no question about it. Then number 5, the characteristic, another characteristic of the biblical Christian is that there is a reception of the gospel. Paul says, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. What did they do? They received the gospel because they knew it came from God. So a true Christian has received the gospel in its truth. Number 6, the true Christian imitates Christ. Look at verse 6a. Paul, speaking to the Thessalonians, says, ye became followers of us and of the Lord. The true Christian follows other true Christians in their testimony, but more importantly, they follow the Lord Jesus Christ. They imitate Christ. not the world. Number seven, true Christians, another characteristic is that they have joy in trials. Paul says to the Thessalonians there in verse 6, he says, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. You know, the Thessalonians were persecuted for their faith, but they counted it joy because of the being willing to suffer for Christ. True Christians have joy in trials. Number 8, and you can see how we're just going through these quickly. Another characteristic of the biblical Christian is that he or she will have an exemplary behavior. Verse 7, Paul says, so that ye were ensamples to all that believe in Macedonia and in Achaia. In other words, wherever the Thessalonians went, people said, there goes a Christian. Whether it's at work or school or at play, a true Christian, wherever he or she goes, exemplifies Christ. Number 9, a true Christian proclaims the word of God. Look at verses 8 to 9a. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God word is spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything, for they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we had unto you. You see, the fact of the matter is, the true Christian proclaims the word of God always. Doesn't hide it. Whether it's through a lifestyle or through progressive action. Number 10, a true Christian will turn from idols. Notice again, verse 9, where Paul says, how that you have turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. What that really means is that the true Christian has repented from that which has taken him from God, and he repents unto God in genuine faith. Today we have a lot of people teaching Christianity without repentance. There is no such thing. There's a turning to Christ from the world. And then the 11th characteristic is an expectation of Christ's return. Verse 10, Paul said to the Thessalonians to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. You see, the true Christian is looking for the rapture. He's waiting for the rapture. It's his blessed hope. Now, these 11 things will be seen in the true Bible-believing, born-again Christian. And the strength of the biblical Christian is that he's a new creature in Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 says, if any man be in Christ, he's a what? Same old person. New creature. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. If you claim that you're a Christian and there's no change from sinfulness and wickedness and unrighteousness and unto serving the Lord Jesus Christ, if you say that you're a Christian and there's no fruit, I am here to say to you today, you are not born again. You'll say you're judging me. Amen. Because that's what the Word of God says. True Christians have a changed life and a fruit. By their fruit you shall know them. Now that's a reference to false teachers. But the fact of the matter is, true Christians are seen by their fruit. Which leads us, as we've looked at the thinking and the characteristics and the strength of the biblical Christian, that leads us to the security of the biblical Christian. Listen, the true Christian has the assurance of salvation. He knows, as it says in 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 through 13, he knows that because he's called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he has everlasting life. And he has eternal security in Christ because he knows, or she knows, I'm just being grammatically correct and I use the word he, but that's part of not being biblically correct or politically correct, but I'm trying to be biblically correct. Are you with me? You see, the person who is truly born-again believer has eternal life, has the assurance of that, and has eternal security in Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ says, no man shall pluck us out of his Father's hand. Thus is a biblical Christian. The question that I ask you today, you say you are a Christian, are you really? Or could you be a cultural Christian, which is a lost person? Could you be a traditional Christian that's probably a lost person? Are you a biblical Christian is the question. In conclusion, let's turn back to the verse of Scripture we read at the beginning of the sermon, which is 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5, where it says this, 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. Paul wrote this to believers at Corinth, Christians. He said, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobate. You know in reality what that verse says? It says, put yourself to the test. Examine yourself. Look at you. Look at you. Can you find a time when you've trusted Jesus Christ as Savior and you know it? I'm not talking about the date. Many people have come to Christ, they don't remember the date, but they do remember the time when they called upon the name of the Lord. And that's what we're talking about. You look at your life and see if you've trusted Christ. If you have trusted Christ, if you have called upon the name of the Lord, then you are a biblical Christian. If you've not yet called upon the name of the Lord to save you, then you need to do it if you want to go to heaven. Now, if you want to go to hell, just live the way you want. That's your choice. But if you want to be saved and born again and on your way to heaven, call upon the name of the Lord and ask Him to save you, because Paul says, know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except to be a reprobate. You know what a reprobate is? It's one who has been put to the test and found wanting. Put your life to the test. And if you cannot say without a doubt, that you've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus to save you, then I encourage you to do it today. For the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Delivered from sin, its power, and its penalty, and its presence through faith in Jesus Christ alone. So you say you're a Christian. Are you really? If you have any doubts today, I encourage you to go to the Lord and say, Lord Jesus, I trust you to save me, and He will. And if you're in this sanctuary, when we give the invitation, I invite you to come forward. We will have people pray with you and take you to a room and talk to you about what salvation is all about. And if you're joining us by Media Ministries and you make that decision for Christ, please contact us that we might be able to talk to you personally about your relationship with the Lord. Make sure that you're not a cultural Christian or a traditional Christian, but a biblical Christian. Let's stand for prayer. Father, you know the need of everyone under the sound of my voice today, and it is my prayer that you'll speak to the hearts of those who may not truly be born again, that today might be the salvation time for them. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing an old hymn, invitational hymn. It's number 294, Just As I Am. You come to Christ just as you are, He will save you. And if you are in this sanctuary, you come. We'll be delighted to talk to you about your relationship with Christ. Number 294.
Thank you for your participation in our worldwide broadcast of the Hour of Faith, which originated from the sanctuary of Faith Baptist Church, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 315 40th Street in the Highland Park section of the city. Dr. Gary G. Dull and the Family of Faith welcomes you to Sunday school at 9:30, morning worship 10:30, Sunday night service at 6, with youth programs and adult prayer and Bible study Wednesday at 7,
with Kids for Truth every Wednesday night at 6:30 during the school year.
If we may ever be of further spiritual help to you, please call 814-944-2894. Log on to our website, www.fbcaltoona.org, or write to the Faith Baptist Church at 315 40th Street, Altoona, Pennsylvania, 16602, USA. Till the next time we meet, may our Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.